Welcome to this HLPF side event at the HLPF 2021, focused on learning lessons from the VNR for the decade of action until 2030. My name is Andrew Griffiths. I'm the head of advocacy at Sightsavers, and we are one of the partners who work together to provide analysis from civil society for the VNRs. And this is one of the resources that Anna from Cooperation Canada will be discussing in our first panel. Our event is split into two panels. In the first, we will hear from Anna de Oliveira from Cooperation Canada and Jon Gieselman from Partners for Review on analysis and identification of good practices around VNR reporting. And in our second panel on country, regional and global lessons from VNR reporting, we will hear from His Excellency Martin Bille-Helmann, from the Danish Ambassador to the United Nations, Ricardo Messiano, Sustainable Development Officer at UNSCAP, and Deirdre de Berke, Forus's Advocacy Coordinator. During each panel, we'll hear from the panelists and then have a chance for Q&A. So can I encourage you throughout the panels, if you have any questions, to put them into the chat box at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and we'll address as many as we can. And also thanks to the interpreters for their support. And a reminder, as you've just heard, if you need interpretation, please do use the interpretation box at the bottom, where you can access the event in English, French, or Spanish. So without much further ado, let's really start and start with our first panel. And I'll do so by handing over to Anna, who is the Research and Knowledge Management Officer at Cooperation Canada. Anna, over to you.
Thanks a lot, Andrew. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon to everyone. So before we begin, I would like to acknowledge that I'm in Canada, in the city of Ottawa, which is the traditional unceded and unsurrendered territory of the Anishinaabe Algonquin Nation. We make this acknowledgement to pay respect and to remind ourselves of the history and contributions of Indigenous communities. We also do this as a reminder of our own position and our role in working against the colonial legacy that leads to discrimination and oppression. So today I'm going to present some aspects of the Progressing National SDGs Implementation Report. This is an independent, civil society-led report carried out every year by a coalition of civil society organizations from across the world. In 2020, which marked the fifth edition of this report, 13 organizations got together and provided their knowledge, expertise, resources, and insights for the development of this work. So next slide, please, Maura. In 2020, 47 countries presented voluntary national reviews, or VNRs, to the high-level political forum. Among those, 26 countries were reporting for the first time, 20 countries reported for the second time, and only one country, Benin, reported for the third time. So the analysis we conducted on these VNRs is done through a team of experienced researchers whose linguistic capacities allow them to focus on the VNR reports in their original languages of publication, namely English, French, Spanish, Arabic, and Russian. So next slide, please. So what is in the Progressing National SDGs Implementation Report? So the four categories that you see in white are the four overarching chapters composing the report. So the first one, governance, institutional mechanisms, and engagement, is the chapter where we look into aspects such as leadership, institutional arrangements, and stakeholder engagement. The second chapter, policies for 2030 agenda implementation, includes gap analysis conducted by the countries producing VNRs, national frameworks, policies, and policy coherence. Third, implementing 2030 agenda includes aspects such as leaving no one behind, localization, partnerships, measurement, and reporting. The fourth chapter on VNR reporting practices, we analyze trends in reporting and consistency of VNR reports against the Secretary General's common reporting guidelines. The other four categories that you see in blue or green refer to best practices and recommendations, which can both be found throughout the report, but also they are consolidated lists in the annexes of the report. Another aspect that is in the annexes is the analytical framework that we use for the research and analysis, and the country profiles, which are 2-3 pagers for each one of the reporting countries that summarizes the key elements of their VNR reports. So today we'll be focusing on best practices and recommendations. So next slide, please. Thank you. So I want to give an idea of how information may appear in the report. So the three boxes that you see refer from left to right to a best practice case study and the recommendation related specific to human rights, which is, of course, an overarching concept of the 2030 agenda. So in this example that you see, a best practice is for the VNR reports to link the implementation of each SDG to national and international human rights frameworks. The case study in this example refers to the creation of a human rights center in Slovenia, as outlined in Slovenia's VNR report. And a recommendation is for reporting countries to ground their plans and strategies for SDG implementation in human rights, and also to have institutions and mechanisms in place to support human rights-based approach to sustainable development. So this is one example, but this, of course, these boxes are also filled with text around them in the report. So next slide, please. This is another example that refers to partnerships. So a best practice in the sense of partnerships is for countries to submit VNR reports that outline the contributions made not only by a national government, but by a wide range of stakeholders as well. In terms of a good practice example, in Solomon Islands, youth participated in the implementation of SDG 16 by engaging candidates in their constituencies to sign political and integrity commitments. As for recommendations on partnerships, reporting states should support other stakeholders to engage in 2030 agenda implementation, for example, by creating a more enabling environment for civil society. Next slide. Thank you. So I invite you all to check the full report, which I'm going to post in the chat in just a minute. So there you will find both quantitative and qualitative analysis. You'll find the historical comparisons between different years VNR reports since 2016 until this fifth edition 2020. And you also find cross analysis between reports, such as this example that you see on the of the Kyrgyz Republic and Samoa, as these two countries outlined challenges encountered in SDG implementation, which is not something that all the reporting countries did. So this is indeed good practice. And so this is the kind of cross analysis that we do between VNR reports. And finally, there you go. Thank you. Just a final piece of information on our report is that the analysis of the VNRs that we do is also complemented by an analysis of civil society reports, which are included according to availability by country. And in this case of this edition, we analyzed, if I'm not mistaken, 8 civil society shadow and spotlight reports. So next, final slide, please. So thank you very much. I look forward to further conversations, and please feel free to email me. I look forward for our discussion. So back to you, Andrew.
Thank you so much, Anna, for that. There's a huge amount of depth to this research, and congratulations and thanks for both your work in leading it and in this presentation. It's really important for us in civil society not only to point out when things are wrong, but also to promote good practice. And I'd encourage all of the participants of this event to go back and to read the report. There's a huge amount in there. We come now to a time of for questions and answers. So all participants, please do put a question that you have in the chat box. We have another opportunity for questions at the end as well. But in this session, if I'm allowed, may I start with just asking and to pick up a point that Jon made. How can VNRs become more inclusive of all stakeholders and ensuring that the voices of the poorest and most marginalized people are heard? So can I ask that question and first start with you, Anna?
Sure, of course. Thanks for this question, Andrew. So one thing that we saw in our report is that the formal inclusion of non-state actors in governance arrangements continues to be an emerging practice. So this was something that was being done in previous years as well. But in this year, that was something more interesting, that instead of this engagement happening through technical working groups, the countries that reported largely mentioned lead councils and committees in which other stakeholders were involved as well. So, but on the other hand, reporting on multi-stakeholder engagement outside of governance arrangement, then on this side, we saw some backslides. But also on the good side, conversely, in terms of engagement in the VNR processes itself, all but one of the reporting countries that presented a full VNR report referred to consultations or engagement of non-state actors to prepare the VNR report. So definitely the VNR is an excellent instrument for this engagement to happen.
Thank you. About how can VNRs promote areas which need real action in order to achieve them, where some of the SDG targets are lagging behind?
I completely agree with what Jordan just said, because if the VNR is just a simple report or an instrument of self-promotion from the countries, then it's complicated. I mean, it has to be used as a guideline for the areas that are lagging to be for action to happen where these areas are lagging. And for example, especially in terms of the 17.11 that we had in the question, this was something that we observed in these VNRs in our last analysis, that information on trade, for example, is something that the countries were not reporting a lot. And also challenges, as I had mentioned in my presentation, is not something that many countries report on. And it's extremely important that they do, that they recognize the challenges so that actions and strategies can be put in place.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you so much to Anna and Jon for your contribution to this first panel. And we'll now move on to the second panel of our event. And we have an eminent group to discuss country, regional and global lessons from VNRs. And again, I'd encourage you to put any questions that you might have into the chat box, as there'll be some time for discussion at the end of this. So we'll start with His Excellency Ambassador Bille, who is the Danish Ambassador to the United Nations. And Ambassador Bille, can please do share with us your perspective on what lessons we need to learn from VNR reporting. Over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Andrew, and thanks for having me this morning or afternoon or evening, depending a little bit on where in the world you you are really happy to take part in this conversation on what we can learn from the VNRs, because I think that learning aspect is so critically important. And in many ways, I mean, HLPF is always an opportunity to take stock on where we are and where we stand on the 2030 agenda. And I suppose even more so this year than usual, because we are 1 year into the decade of action, but we are also on the verge of a global recovery from COVID-19, even though we are still, if you like, somewhat in the tunnel still. Now, I think it's clear, and I think it's important that we all recognize that the pandemic has jeopardized decades of progress. We've seen rising poverty, we've seen exacerbated inequalities, we've seen backtracking on human rights and shrinking civic space. And then I think we've seen sort of a dangerous slowdown on climate action. And the reality, of course, is that even before we were not moving at the pace we were supposed to. We were not moving in the direction we were supposed to if to meet the sustainable development by 2030. That's why I want to use this opportunity to focus also a little bit sort of on the potential and power of partnerships to do more, to do it faster, and to do it in the right direction. Because only by coming together across borders and sectors, across different stakeholders, if you like, we have a chance to truly build back better and to keep our promise. And I think that's crucially important, of leaving no one behind. Now, this year, Denmark will present our second VNR, and I just want to highlight sort of a few changes when compared to the first one, because I think one thing clearly stands out in comparison to the first one, and that's the importance of collaboration and inclusion of all levels and all stakeholders. That's why the VNR, the Danish VNR report this time around is not just the government's report, it's all of society's report, from civil society to the private sector to government at the national level and at the local level. I think one of the clearest examples of this is that you will find chapters and recommendations in the report, not written or edited by government officials, but coming directly from civil society and other actors in the report. So uncensored and critical when there is a need to be this. And I think, you know, from the Danish side, from the official side, we've taken this approach not just because we think it's the right thing to do, but actually also because it's the smart thing to do. It adds value. It allows us, all of us, to achieve more. Now, governments clearly have a big role to play, but we cannot hide, and we should not hide from their responsibility. But in order to get all the way, we must engage, we must include, and we must cooperate with all parts of society. We simply need all hands on deck to make this happen. That's true for those that have the furthest to go, and it's true for some of us that doesn't have as far to go as others. Because the reality is, when politicians, when civil society, when youth, unions, the private sector, and other stakeholders interact, then it's easier to identify with a certain level of precision local issues, but also, and I think that's the key part here, to mobilize targeted action towards the 2030 agenda, and to do so in a local context. Basically, how do we turn global goals into local action? Now, the chance of getting it right is simply much higher if we listen to what you might call sort of experts of experience at the ground, and empower those that are actually closest to the action to make the necessary changes. Now, building partnerships and ensuring stakeholder engagement, both at the local level, at the regional level, and at the national level, even global level, doesn't happen on its own. It doesn't happen out of the blue, and it can definitely not be taken for granted. It's hard work, but it must be made a priority. Now, in Denmark, we have a fairly strong tradition of working together across sectors. Now, civic engagement, strong labor and business unions, and a well-rooted democracy, both at the local and national level, has shaped Danish society and continues to do so. And people recognize that it's that partnership, that it's that collaboration that has taken us to where we are today. This doesn't mean that we can't learn from others. For Denmark, I think the VNR process is much about listening to others, asking questions of others, inspiration elsewhere in the world. And I'm sure the panel will discuss today, there's still plenty of actions to be taken also in Denmark, and we will present our report a little bit later this morning. What I would like to highlight sort of a few insights from the VNR process and the implementation of this. First of all, I think making the 2030 agenda, a joint venture across all sectors and levels of society. I think that's extremely important. And as I already mentioned, making the VNR report more than just a government report is one very concrete step. Secondly, I think key to ensure parliamentary oversight and engagement. Now, in the Danish parliament, members from all political parties have come together in a cross-party SDG network, and the implementation of the goals have actually been anchored in the Committee of Finance in order to ensure high priority, and that actually this is taken into consideration when you budget government budgets. And thirdly, I want to highlight the importance of building truly inclusive institutions. You know, from municipalities and local communities to the United Nations itself, you know, we need both the push and the pull from civil society to keep decision makers on their toes and to ensure accountability. And that's why we work very hard to include civil society in all UN processes, and why we cannot allow the pandemic to be used to curb civic space and disregard human rights. These are efforts that we need to take both at the local level, the national level, the regional level, and the global level. This is hard work, and later today, I'm sure you will hear Danish civil society criticize government for not doing enough. That's not always comfortable, but it's needed. No? Colleagues, let me just sum up by saying that in order to build back better and greener for everyone, you know, the essence is, and this is to some extent a truism, it ought to be a truism, but it needs to be said, we need to do it with everyone. And that's why I think partnership is the key that will unlock progress on all SDGs, both globally and locally. Now, the COVID-19 pandemic is a historic challenge, but it is also a historic opportunity to reimagine and rebuild the world with the 2030 agenda as our guiding star, with the SDGs as our compass. So let's seize the opportunity, let's do this together. That's the only way we can get on the right path. And thank you so much, Andrew. I really look forward to the discussion today.
Thank you so much, Ambassador. Sorry, my video seems to not be working. thank you so much for that presentation, and my best wishes to you for the presentation of the Danish VNR today. Hope it goes extremely well. And thank you for highlighting a range of important areas: parliamentary oversight, inclusive institutions, civil society engagement, amongst others. And as you said, I liked it when you said that multi-stakeholder engagement is not always comfortable, but it is needed. You also noted cross-border partnerships, which are a critical area that maybe don't get the attention that they need. And one of the important forums that they can be discussed and addressed is at the regional level. So I'll now pass over to Ricardo Messiano, who's a Sustainable Development Officer at UNSCAP. From UNSCAP's perspective in your region, what are the good practices that you're seeing, and how can we learn from those in VNR reporting? So over to you, Ricardo.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Thank you, everyone, for hosting us. It's a great opportunity for us to talk a little bit of what the regional level ESCAP as a regional commission does and try to contribute for supporting the VNRs, and also try to understand what's happening at the regional level at the for the preparation and the finalization of the reports. ESCAP has been at the forefront, if you want, in supporting, in cooperation with the resident coordinator at the national level and the country teams, and numbers of countries over these years, for somehow supporting them in the preparatory process for the VNR, and not only at the level of technical assistance, but also trying to understand a little bit, like our friend Jorn and partners for use does, trying to do an analysis of the VNRs of each year to understand if there are some similarities, some common challenges, and also best practices innovation. And the good news, I would say, is that for this year, 2021, things are moving. Most of the countries in Asia and the Pacific presenting this year, is 12 in total, are countries that come back for a second or a third time. Indonesia and Azerbaijan are two countries that have already done the report. We've already done the report three times this year. And what we are analyzing is that the VNR process is more and more innovative, forward-looking, and trying to, especially in these challenging times of the pandemic, being trying to be as inclusive as possible with all the limitation that, of course, the pandemic creates. This year, what was interesting in noticing from the analysis of the regional level of the countries that prepared the report is that they really wanted to take stock, especially countries coming back for a second and a third time. Well, what happened during the first time, VNR? Until a couple of years ago, we realized that even when countries presented the second report, they were somehow starting from scratch. So, and you know, this happens all the time because there might be limited institutional memory at the country level. People in the government, in the planning ministries, or whoever is in charge might change. So, in some instances, countries even coming back for a second or third time, they were just repeating their process. But for example, this year, and I won't really pinpoint and mention LAO-PDR, they really took stock of what happened in the first report. You know, there is a section in the VNR report, which is the last one, which is somehow kind of recommendation, looking forward, very forward. And the LAO-PDR really took stock of what happened in the first time, what happened since the first time, and trying to build their report along those lines. It was great to see because it really creates a continuum. And the other thing that we have been noticing in our analysis is that countries really try to navigate this pandemic somehow and trying to be as innovative as possible to include and to be as inclusive as more and more inclusive and getting voices heard in the preparatory process, in the preparation of the report that maybe didn't do it before. For example, Azerbaijan, a country, as I was telling you, coming back for the third time, they realized that in the first two reports, they hadn't involved enough the private sector. Well, they organize, they have an amazing, a very effective online system of consultation. They really invested heavily on getting the voice of the private sector heard. And other examples are, for example, Bhutan. Bhutan, coming back for a second time, so he's a second time presenter, they realized clearly that preparing the report this year with the pandemic would have been very challenging. They put up a very interesting system of online consultation when really each and every sector of the society was involved. And this was great because the innovation, the innovative spirit that they brought in was really remarkable. The reality is that the analysis of what's happening is incredible. Is really impressive. The government, in many instances, put things together and trying to be to really involve as much as possible the society. But I wanted to talk to you, as I conclude my intervention, also some kind of innovation that ESCA tried to bring in the state play already 2 years ago. What we realized was that there was lots of appetite from our member countries to somehow getting together and getting at the level of peer review that was really concrete and as effective as possible. So we designed a VNR twinning program, which actually put together and combined two countries, usually a country presenting a report for the first time and a country presenting a report for a second time. The program was very successful last year, where we connected countries from North and Central Asia. So from one side, Kyrgyzstan and Armenia, and on the other side, Uzbekistan and Georgia. And what we did was really creating a very strong connection between these two pairs of countries, where we connected piece by piece all the different sectors of the society. So we had a study tour, we had an online consultation, we created an online platform where each parallel segment of the society involved in the preparatory process could connect and exchange ideas, stories, challenges, and everything that could happen. So the national statistician with the national statistician, the civil society network with the civil society network. And this, what we realized, this was really coming and responded to a call that came strong from the countries. We started to do it also this year, connecting two countries in our region, that was actually Myanmar and Indonesia. But then, of course, with the political situation, we had to stall and freeze this cooperation. But this is a program that we are really we're really investing in, and we really believe in. So again, our friends like Jon from Partner for Views, they already know about it, and we are trying to export it as much as possible. And I really want to use also this side event to promote this this idea, because it's really, in my opinion, among the all UN-led initiatives that sometimes are not very straight to the point and parachuting into a country experience, this is really, really helping. So it's all for me, and happy to answer any question that might arise. And again, thank you so much, Andrew, for hosting me.
Oh, no, thank you, Ricardo. Thank you so much for that and sharing important innovations, and particularly VNR twinning, which is hopefully, as you say, something we can see more in other regions as well, and even between regions in the future. So last but very much not least, I'll pass to my colleague Deirdre de Becker, who is the Forus's advocacy coordinator. So Deirdre, from your experience working with CSO networks around the world, what are the good practices that we can learn from a civil society perspective?
Thanks very much, Andrew, and hello everybody. I'm very happy to be speaking here on behalf of Forus today. So maybe I'll start with my first slide, just really introducing Forus for those of you who are not familiar with the network. So Forus is a global civil society network of 68 national NGO platforms and 7 regional coalitions from across 5 continents. And our network is a legitimate catalyst and a representative of the voice of NGOs worldwide. And amongst other things, it provides capacity building and advocacy support to its members for monitoring and implementing the 2030 agenda. And Forus places a particular emphasis in its advocacy work on supporting its members to engage more effectively with VNR processes. Next slide, please. So for some global feedback then on VNR processes that essentially have been gathered from our members, and really I'm going to try and summarize that key feedback and reporting on the VNR processes that has been shared with the network by Forus members from all over the world. And these key trends were really identified as part of the reflection within the network when it was preparing its submission to the UN High Level Political Forum review. And we have a paper on our website, if anybody's interested in looking at that, where we summarize a lot of the experiences of our members of the VNR processes. But some key issues and trends that were identified by Forus, I'd like to present here today. And these issues concerned, firstly, the participation of CSOs in VNR processes. Secondly, the impact of civil society organizations on VNR processes. And thirdly, the quality of VNRs being developed. And again, these are the perceptions of civil society from different countries around the world. So next slide, please. So the participation of CSOs in VNR processes. Well, firstly, CSOs are not always aware of official VNR processes. And in other words, they're not clear about how governments are going to organize the VNR process. And sometimes they only find out very much at the last moment. So there's a lack of clarity about how the consultation processes for the preparation of the VNRs are to take place. That's more the case in some countries than others, but it is a dominant trend. The second issue that very much came up in the feedback we got from our members is about the short duration of the official VNR preparation processes. They often start in January of the year in which the VNR will be presented. And again, that only allows a couple of months to carry out an extensive national and local consultation. Thirdly, there's not always a clear VNR focal point for civil society organizations in the relevant government department that's responsible for preparing the VNR. Again, a very practical issue, but one that does make a big difference if civil society organizations are trying to find out how they can engage or best engage with the VNR process. In many cases, there's no clear leave no one behind engagement strategy in place. And this is something that's absolutely essential, a well thought out strategy to ensure by government, to ensure the participation of socially excluded or marginalized groups in the preparation of the VNR. And linked to this, consultation processes for VNR preparations in the last year or two have been increasingly done online or digitally because of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, this does put the process of consultation then out of reach for many sections of the population who lack literacy and both digital access and digital skills to actually be able to participate in the consultation. And finally, local level VNR consultations are often overlooked. And that is a pity because the importance of local level consultations on the preparation of the VNR really needs to be recognized by governments. And I would just like to mention Nepal, our member in Nepal, who's been involved very extensively in local level negotiations. And again, it does make a big difference in raising public awareness and public engagement with the VNR process when there's a very, you know, well-structured approach to consulting locally. Next slide, please. Now I'm going to look at the impact, the perceived impact of civil society organisations on the VNR processes. So firstly, our members report to us that they're increasingly making written contributions to the VNR process. And again, that's linked to the fact of the COVID pandemic, that a lot of the consultation is happening online. So the impact of these inputs is unclear. So many of our members say that the impacts of their written inputs to the process are not visible in the final VNR. But in terms of best practice, in a few countries that are notable, CSOs are actually asked either to write a chapter or a section of their country's VNR, or they have their parallel or spotlight reports included in the annexes to the national VNR. So that is something very positive. I won't say it's a broad trend, but certainly there's enough examples of that now to feel hopeful that many other governments may follow suit. CSOs do report that the development of a parallel or a spotlight report by civil society, often as part of a broader SDG coalition, is a key means to have some impact, and that they find that once governments are aware that they're preparing a parallel or a spotlight report, that the governments take more note and make more of an effort to include their inputs into the report, into the official VNR. In terms of other good practice, CSOs are sometimes included in official VNR delegations from their country, and this is something we would definitely like to encourage. I think it does make a big difference for a representative of civil society to be included in their national delegation, presenting at the high-level political forum, and it also really does seem to help in terms of improving CSO engagement with government, because the kind of engagement that's necessary in order to be part of a national delegation and fully on top of how the government is going to present and what they're going to present means that relations really strengthen, and that's something very positive that we would like to encourage. Next slide, please. So the quality of the VNRs is the last thing I'm going to look at here today. So there's no convincing evidence, certainly in terms of feedback from Forus members, to suggest that governments are consistently using the updated UN Secretary General's guidelines on the VNRs or producing a VNR, or the UNDESA handbook to guide how they organize their VNR processes. And again, our members, we really encourage them to advocate for this in advance of the VNR being prepared, so that even before their government starts to prepare its VNR, that civil society is reminding the government of the existence of these high quality and recently revised guidelines for producing VNRs, and also the UNDESA handbook, which is a really excellent resource for the preparation of VNRs. So the preparation of VNRs does provide opportunities to share lessons learned, main challenges faced, successes, and so on. However, as other speakers have said, some governments do perceive the VNRs largely as a PR opportunity. This can be very frustrating, but it is understandable that with the limits of a 15 to 20 minute presentation, governments often feel they need to highlight their successes rather than the challenges and the failures. So this really does point to the need for other formats where governments can also present their VNRs, but maybe allow more time for a more nuanced presentation where they can also highlight the difficulties and challenges faced. And finally, in many cases, VNR processes do lack information on follow-up processes. And this leads, as the previous speaker has said, to a lack of continuity between one VNR and the subsequent one. There's often intense engagement of different stakeholders before the VNR is presented to the high-level political forum. And then, unfortunately, the process is largely becomes quite marginal until the next opportunity to present a VNR occurs. Next slide, please. So just some recommendations for the future. Very briefly, there's many recommendations that I could make, but just trying to summarize some of the key ones. So firstly, and this is something that Forus really believes, having participated in the steering group for the last number of years of the report, which our Canadian member, Cooperation Canada, just presented, and just like to pay tribute to the work that Anna and her colleagues put into producing that report. But there is a need for more coordinated research and analysis of VNRs in order to identify and to promote best practice. So we would like to see, you know, the kind of analysis that's being done by Partners for Review, the independent CSO analysis in which many of our own organizations are involved, and any work by UNDESA and others, to be coordinated more and to be gathered and used for the purposes of improving best practice and promoting best practice in the VNR. So we would really encourage this research and analysis to be linked to exercises or mechanisms like the VNR labs that happen around the high level political forum and around the regional sustainable development forums. So we need to really think about how this VNR related research and analysis, particularly around best practice, can be captured and feed into those labs and into other VNR capacity building across the UN system. Secondly, we need to create more VNR related multi-stakeholder capacity development opportunities at national and regional level. So this is something that Forus believes would really help to promote partnerships if we brought different stakeholder groups together more for the purposes of capacity development. There's a lot of opportunity for it, and we particularly believe that the regional level and the regional sustainable development forums are a great moment to do that, and we need to exploit those opportunities more. We also need to promote more consistent use of the Secretary General's VNR guidelines and also the UNDESA's handbook through this capacity building. So it is a way of trying to introduce greater, and we won't say standardization, but certainly to promote, you know, good quality VNRs across all countries who are reporting. Also, the UN High Level Political Forum and the UN system in general needs to give more profile to the findings of the CSO Shadow and Spotlight reports linked to the VNR processes. And as we've said already, some governments are including them in annexes to their reports. I know the UN system itself has agreed that there will be some way of displaying the CSO Shadow and Spotlight reports on their websites. But the point to be made is that there's really good quality analysis very often in these CSO Shadow and Spotlight reports. A lot of work goes into them, but they're often overlooked in the absence of a more official profile being given to them. That's something that's really important in terms of Forus members and other civil society partners. And finally, and this is a point that was raised by other speakers, we do really need to encourage more focus on VNR follow-up processes. So there's a real weakness in the VNR system at the moment, linked to the fact that the VNRs often don't contain concrete commitments for action. So we need to encourage governments to think of the VNR as a continuous process at national level, with opportunities to present at the international level every few years, but that the national process should be something that's dynamic and ongoing. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'll hand back to you now, Andrew.
Thank you so much, Deirdre, and some extremely helpful recommendations there, and also some advice for civil society. I think it's particularly striking how many of the recommendations and insights from the panelists have agreed with one another. So I think that shows some consistency and something that we can definitely something we can build on. We come to a time now for some questions, and thank you so much for the questions that have been sent in. We'll try to answer as many as possible, but apologies in advance if we don't get to your question. So first, might I address a couple to you, Ambassador Beer. Two questions. Firstly, from Zosa, who asks, does Denmark have a national multi-stakeholder SDG advisory body like Belgium and Germany? And secondly, what steps can donors take to support their partners in adopting best practice where the development of VNRs are concerned? What are your thoughts on those two questions?
No, good question. I don't think we have a body called exactly that, but we have different types of multi-stakeholder platforms that are used for these types of interactions. No, and I think, you know, the point that was made by Deirdre, I think so important that these processes are not sort of something you do every 2 or 3 or 4 years. I mean, the important thing is how do you institutionalize these things, not only in terms of actually making sure the government delivers on what it has promised, but actually also in terms of mobilizing the type of engagement that is needed, whether that's at the national level or at the local level. So I don't think we have a body called exact that, but we have different types of multi-stakeholder bodies meant to do that. Also in specific sectors, we have a youth climate council that advises the Minister for Climate and Energy on climate policies. Now, what can countries do to help each other? I think one of the things that we can do is we can spend more time listening to each other, actually. I think later today, Denmark will present its VNR. I think we'll be given 10 minutes for the presentation, then there'll be 10 minutes to ask questions. I don't really think that's sufficient time to have a sort of an in-depth discussion where we can learn from each other. Now, a country like Denmark, who has for more than 40 years that have been heavily engaged in development assistance and development cooperation with a number of key partners abroad, of course, can do more on a day-to-day basis. But I do think this idea of using the UN as a platform for peer learning, I think is so important. And so I would love to see the HLPF sort of increasingly turning into a workshop, a VNR workshop, where countries, and with countries, I don't only mean governments, but different types of stakeholders, use the opportunity to learn from each other. Now, on Monday, we had a side event where Statistics Denmark hosted for us to share some of our lessons, both when it comes to the VNR, but actually also when it comes to actually measuring progress towards the SDGs. So can we turn the HLPF into a much more concrete hands-on learning workshop? I think that would be a step in the right direction.
Thank you. Can I ask a very quick follow-up question to that, which is, we recently had the review of the HLPF, and of course there was an opportunity to increase those spaces for learning and sharing. And what's your reflection as to why maybe that hasn't happened to the degree that we would hope it would?
It's a very good question, and one I ask myself on a number of occasions, not only when it comes to HLPF. I suppose the reality is that the UN, and with the UN, I don't mean the UN that the Secretary General and his peers heads, but the UN that is the United Nations, you know, 193 member states, and how we negotiate intergovernmentally. That's very sort of traditional, the way we do that. We've been doing this for 75 years. It can do a lot of things. It moves slowly. And changing course is difficult. I think we have an opportunity with the disruption to some extent caused by COVID-19, but I think we have an opportunity to learn a few things from this virtual world that all of us have been sort of forced into, some with greater ease than others. I have myself struggled still to mute and unmute. But I think there are opportunities here that in the post-pandemic world, we need to try and see how we can actually use these hybrid formats to much, much greater effect. So that when you have an HLPF, it is actually an opportunity to have a more inclusive learning process. It doesn't necessarily require everybody to travel to New York. That's one thing. The other thing is, I think we have to recognize that changes at the UN is not something that happens rapidly. But you don't always need 193 member states to agree to do things. You can do things on the sidelines as we are doing. But if we had more structure, more focus on this, then I think you would be able to use occasions like HLPF to great effect, even if it was not part of the official program. So continue to push on inside the UN, but don't wait for the 193 member states to agree to change things. Then we won't get there by 2030.
Thank you so much for that. I think two examples. I think VNR labs and voluntary local reviews are ones which have people have just got on and done, and they've been now reflected in the resolution. Ricardo or Deirdre, do you have any insights or anything to add on those questions, or I'll move on to another one.
I just posted, thank you, Andrew. I just quickly posted the ESCAP as in relation to the VLR as been looking a lot on the connection between VLRs and VNRs. And even in our technical assistance we provided in Malaysia and Thailand this year, we have been trying to push together with the local and central government to make it clear that the two processes, the VLR and VNR, can really walk and in end. And please have a look at these guidelines, and if there is any need of follow up, I can be available. But indeed, there is a lot that has been done until now, and in many countries already, VLRs are an integral part of the VNR preparatory process. Over.
Maybe a very quick point, Andrew, just before you finish. I think the increased emphasis and focus on SDG 17, particularly its capacity building commitments, I think it's really important. And I think, you know, multi-stakeholder partnerships are not going to become a reality until we bring people from different sectors together and develop their shared understanding of Agenda 2030 and the challenges and the opportunities around the implementation of this very ambitious and exciting but time-bound agenda. So to me, that's a key to really promoting best practice in the VNRs as well. So how can we do this? How can we operationalize SDG 17 so that we do place an increasing emphasis on and over the coming years and bringing different stakeholder groups together and developing their capacities together so that they can implement together and monitor together effectively? Thank you.
Thank you, Deirdre. And I think linked to that, there's a question from Paul in the chat box, which is about strategies or channels that we can allow voices of civil society organizations to be heard, and he particularly highlights the Eastern DRC, where he says people are being killed, massacred and live on the move day by day. So a question about how do we do that, and how can we support engagement on things like VNRs in fragile contexts like that in Eastern DRC? Any thoughts on that from you, Deirdre?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I suppose one of the advantages of being a global network is that our members find themselves in all kinds of different national contexts. And I suppose they range on a spectrum from, you know, more stable and you know, contexts where it's easy to engage with the VNR process and so on, to ones that you've just described there, which are very, very difficult. And I suppose for me, I think the emphasis on the local level comes back again. I mean, you know, very often, if there are a lot of stability issues in a country, there's not much that can be done in terms of trying to you know, bring about stability at the national level. But I think certainly at the local level, local people coming together, you know, developing their own local VNRs and so on, and finding ways. And I think, again, that's where civil society, even maybe where a government is not functioning necessarily as it should be or whatever, but, you know, civil society engaging in sort of multi-stakeholder, you know, forums and processes also to try to reach some kind of consensus on the development needs, the development, you know, the progress that, and the challenges that are being faced at the local level, and to communicate that. Because I think, again, we do have to make some kind of, you know, we do have to recognize the fact that not, you know, in some cases, governments or countries will not be in a position necessarily because of internal difficulties and so on to maybe participate in the VNR process every, you know, at every opportunity in the way that we would like them to. So we have to make some kind of allowances also for countries that are in a situation where it's very difficult to do so. And how can we facilitate other voices to at least be heard so that when the progress of, you know, a given country is being considered, that, you know, there's some data, some information, some information from the local level that's credible and that's, you know, from the ground up, so that it can provide some, you know, evidence base for, if in the case of you know, investment from external investment or political decision making. I think that would be really important. It's not an easy question to answer, but I think we do have to try to think through, yeah, how we help our members in those countries where perhaps their governments are not functioning as well as we would like them to be to, in order to be able to participate in this process.
Thank you so much. Any final thoughts from either you, Ambassador Bido, or Ricardo on this?
Oh, perhaps just a quick thought. I agree with what Deirdre said. I think, you know, to leverage partnerships, you need to put in the hard work to establish them and to nurture them. And that needs to be done outside sort of this high profile event. And I think an important part here is actually the establishment of these partnerships at the local level, where people live, where they have their daily lives, at their workplaces, and try to look at all the existing partnerships that are out there. This is not necessarily always about new partnerships, but it's also about, if you like, refurbishing you know, traditional partnerships, giving them a language around the SDGs, a new sense of direction and a new sense of purpose. This is not a question always of replacing existing partnerships with new ones, but setting direction also for existing ones. But thanks so much for convening us. I think you're a key part of this learning, getting inspiration from others. And I've definitely learned a lot, not only from the earlier speakers, but also from Deirdre and Ricardo. So thank you so much.
Just Andrew, many thanks, Ambassador, for raising this this issue of existing partnership. I just wanted to complement this in 1 minute. In many countries, especially the smallest one, I'm not saying something completely new, but the difference from government and civil society is very tiny. Is in some island in the Pacific, people usually move from being part of the civil society to government and back. So in some realities, this partnership are also very immediate, so very easily to leverage. It's really just a matter of recognizing them and providing the tools at the national level to leverage them. But as I say, in some instances, this is already happening and is also very easy to lift up.
Well, thank you so much for that. And unfortunately, we come to the end of our event now. But I believe that many of the discussions that have started won't end with the ending of this event. So I'd like to thank and extend my thanks to everybody for attending. We hope you found it an interesting and helpful event. I certainly did. And a special thanks to all of our panelists, to Anna, to Yuan, to Ambassador Bieber, to Ricardo, and to Deirdre. And thank you so much for sharing your insights with us today. I believe it was a very varied, fascinating, and important discussion. So thank you once again. Have a great last few days of the 2021 HLPF. And again, best wishes to you, Ambassador, for the presentation of Denmark's VNR. So thanks, everybody, and goodbye.
Thanks a lot, Andrew. Thanks, everybody.
Thank Bye. You, too, for the interesting thank session.
Bye. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.